We who were saved, the minority of our transport, found out the truth in the evening. I inquired from prisoners who had been there for some time where my colleague and friend P had been sent. Was he sent to the left side? Yes, I replied. Then you can see him there, I was told. Where? A hand pointed to the chimney a few hundred yards off, which was sending a column of flame up into the grey sky of Poland. It dissolved into a sinister cloud of smoke. That's where your friend is, floating up to heaven, was the answer. But I still did not understand until the truth was explained to me in plain words. But I am telling things out of their turn. From a psychological point of view, we had a long, long way in front of us from the break of the dawn at the station until our first night's rest at the camp. Escorted by SS guards with loaded guns, we were made to run from the station past electrically charged barbed wire through the camp to the cleansing station. For those of us who had passed the first selection, this was a real bath. Again, our illusion to reprieve found confirmation. The SS man seemed almost charming. Soon, we found out their reason. They were nice to us as long as they saw watches on our wrist and could persuade us in well-meaning tones to hand them over. Would we not have to hand over all our possessions anyway? And why should not that relatively nice person have the watch? Maybe one day he would do one a good turn. We waited in a shed which seemed to be the anteroom to the disinfecting chamber. SS men appeared and spread out blankets into which we had to throw all our possessions, all our watches and jewelry. There were still knife prisoners among us who asked, to the amusement of the more seasoned ones who were there as helpers, if they could not keep a wedding ring, a medal or a good luck piece. No one could yet grasp the fact that everything would be taken away. I tried to take one of the old prisoners into my confidence. Approaching him furtively, I pointed to a roll of the paper in the inner pocket of my coat and said, "Look, this is the manuscript of a scientific book. I know what you will say, that I should be grateful to escape with my life. That should be all I can expect of fate. But I cannot help myself. I must keep this manuscript at all cost. It contains my life's work. Do you understand that?" Yes, he was beginning to understand. A grin spread slowly over his face, first piteous, then more amused, mocking, insulting, until he bellowed one word at me in answer to my question, a word that was ever present in the vocabulary of the camp inmates. Shit! At that moment, I saw the plain truth and did what marked the culminating point of the first phase of my psychological reaction. I struck out my whole formal life. Suddenly, there was a stir among my fellow travelers who had been standing out with pale, frightened faces, helplessly debating. Again, we heard the hoarsely shouted commands. We were driven with blows into the immediate anteroom of the path. There we assembled around an SS man who waited until we had all arrived. Then he said, "I will give you 2 minutes and I shall give time you by my watch. In this 2 minutes, you will get fully undressed and drop everything on the floor where you are standing. You will take nothing with you except your shoes, your belt or suspenders and possibly a dress. I'm starting to count now." With unthinkable haste, people tore off their clothes. As the time grew shorter, they became increasingly nervous and pulled clumsily at their underwear, belts and shoelaces. Then we heard the first sounds of whipping, leather straps beating down on naked bodies. Next, we were herded into another room to be shaved. Not only our heads were shorn, but not a hair was left on our entire bodies. Then onto the showers where we lined up again. We hardly recognized each other, but with great relief some people noted that real water dripped from the sprays. While we were waiting for the shower, our nakedness was brought home to us. We really had nothing now except our bare bodies. Even minus hair, all we possessed literally was our naked existence. What else remained for us as a material link with our former lives. For me, there were my glasses and my belt. The latter I had to exchange later on for a piece of bread. There was an extra bit of excitement in the store for the owners of dresses. In the evening, the senior prisoner in charge of our hut welcomed us with a speech in which he gave us his word of honor that he would hang personally from that beam he pointed to it any person who had sewn money or precious stones into his dress. Proudly, he explained that as a senior inhabitant, the camp laws entitle him to do so. Where our shoes were concerned, matters were not so simple. Although we were supposed to keep them, those who had fairly decent pairs had to give them up after all and were given in exchange shoes that did not fit. In for real trouble were those prisoners who had followed the apparently well-meant advice of the senior prisoners and had shortened their jackboots by cutting the tops off, then smearing soap on the cut edges to hide the sabotage. The SS man seemed to have waited for just that. All suspected of this crime had to go into a small adjoining room. After a time, we again heard the lashings of the strap and the screams of the tortured man. This time it lasted for quite a while. Thus the illusions some of us still had were destroyed one by one, and then, quietly and unexpectedly, most of us were overcome by a grim sense of humor. We knew that we had nothing to lose except our so ridiculously naked lives. When the showers started to run, we all tried very hard to make fun, both about ourselves and about each other. After all, real water did flow from the sprays. Apart from the strange kind of humor, another sensation seized us, curiosity. I have experienced this kind of curiosity before as a fundamental reaction towards certain strange circumstances. When my life was once endangered by a climbing accident, I felt only one sensation at the critical moment. Curiosity as to whether I should come out of it alive or with a fractured skull or some other injuries. Cold curiosity predominate even in Auschwitz, somehow detaching the mind from its surroundings, which came to be regarded with a kind of objectivity. At that time, one cultivated this state of mind as a means of protection. We were anxious to know what would happen next and what would be the consequence, for example, of us standing in the open air in the chill of late autumn, stark naked and still wet from the showers. In the next few days, our curiosity evolved into surprise. Surprise that we did not catch cold. There were many similar surprises in the store for new arrivals. The medical men among us learned first of all. Textbooks tell lies. Somewhere it is said that man cannot exist without sleep for more than a stated number of hours. Quite wrong. I had been convinced that there were certain things I just could not do. I could not sleep without this, or I could not live with that or the another. The first night in Auschwitz, we slept in beds which were constructed in tires. On each tire slept 9 men directly on the boards. 2 blankets were shared by each 9 men. We could, of course, lie only on our sides, crowded and huddled against each other, which had some advantages because of the bitter cold. Though it was forbidden to take shoes up to the bunks, some people did use them secretly as pillows in spite of the fact that they were caked with mud. Otherwise, one's head had to rest on the crook of an almost dislocated arm. And yet sleep came and brought oblivion and relief from pain for a few hours. I would like to mention a few similar surprises on how much we could endure. We were unable to clean our teeth, and yet in spite of that and a severe vitamin deficiency, we had healthier gums than ever before. We had to wear the same shirts for half a year until they had lost all appearance of being shirts. For days, we were unable to wash, even partially because of frozen water pipes, and yet the sores and abrasions on hands, which were dirty from work in the soil, did not suppurate. Or, for instance, a light sleeper who used to be disturbed by the slightest noise in the next room now found himself lying pressed against a comrade who snored loudly a few inches from his ear and yet slept quite soundly through the noise. If someone now asked of us the truth of Dostoevsky's statement that flatly defines man as a being who can get used to anything, we would reply yes. A man can get used to anything, but do not ask us how. But our psychological investigations have not taken us that far yet. Neither had we prisoners reached that point. We were still in the first phase of our psychological reactions. The thought of suicide was entertained by nearly everyone, if only for a brief time. It was born of the hopelessness of the situation, the constant danger of death looming over us daily and hourly, and the closeness of the death suffered by many of the others. From personal convictions, which will be mentioned here, I made myself a firm promise on my first evening in camp that I would not run into the wire. This was a phrase used in camp to describe the most popular method of suicide, touching the electrically charged barbed wire fence. It was not entirely difficult for me to make this decision. There was little point in committing suicide, since for the average inmate, life expectation, calculating objectively and counting all likely chances, was very poor. He could not with any assurance expect to be among the small percentage of men who survive all the selections. The prisoner of Auschwitz, in the first phase of shock, did not fear death. Even the gas chambers lost their horrors for him after the first few days. After all, they spared him the act of committing suicide. Friends whom I have met later have told me that I was not one of those whom the shock of admission greatly depressed. I only smiled, and quite sincerely, when the following episode occurred the morning after our first night in Auschwitz. In spite of strict orders not to leave our blocks, a colleague of mine who had arrived in Auschwitz several weeks previously smuggled himself into our hut. He wanted to calm and comfort us and tell us a few things. He had come so thin that at first we did not recognize him. With a show of good humor and a devil-may-care attitude, he gave us few hurried tips. Don't be afraid. Don't fear the selections. Dr. M, the SS medical chief, has a soft spot for doctors. This was wrong. My friend's kindly words were misleading. One prisoner, the doctor of a block of huts, and a man of some 60 years told me how he had entreated Dr. M to let off his son who was destined for gas. Dr. M coldly refused. "But one thing I beg of you," he continued, "shave daily, if at all possible. Even if you have to use a piece of glass to do it, even if you have to give your last piece of bread for it, you will look younger. And the scrapping will make your cheeks look ruddier. If you want to stay alive, there is only one way. Look fit for work. If you even limp, because, let us say, you have a small blister on your heel, and an assessment spots this, he will wave you aside and the next day you are sure to be gassed. Do you know what we mean by a Muslim? A man who looks miserable, down and out, sick and emaciated, and who cannot manage hard physical labor any longer. That is a Muslim. Sooner or later, usually sooner, every Muslim goes to the gas chambers. Therefore, remember, shave, stand and walk smartly. Then you need not be afraid of gas. All of you are standing here. Even if you have only been here for 24 hours, you need not fear gas, except perhaps you." And then he pointed to me and said, "I hope you don't mind my telling you frankly." To the others, he repeated, "Of all of you, he is the only one who must fear the next election. So don't worry." And I smiled. I am now convinced that anyone in my place on that day would have done the same. I think it was Lessing who once said, "There are things which must cause you to lose your reason, or you have none to lose. An abnormal reaction to an abnormal situation is a normal behavior." Even we psychiatrists expect the reactions of a man to an abnormal situation, such as being committed to an asylum, to be abnormal in proportion to the degree of his normality. The reaction of a man to his admission to a concentration camp also represents an abnormal state of mind, but just objectively it is a normal and, as will be shown later, typical reaction to the given circumstances. These reactions, as I have described them, began to change in a few days. The prisoner passed from the first to the second phase, the phase of relatively apathy in which he achieved a kind of emotional death. Apart from the already described reactions, the newly arrived prisoner experienced the tortures of other most painful emotions, all of which he tried to deaden. First of all, there was his boundless longing for his home and his family. This often could become so acute that he felt himself consumed by longing. Then there was disgust. Disgust with all the ugliness which surrounded him, even in its mere external forms. Most of the prisoners were given a uniform of rags which would have made a scarecrow elegant by comparison. Between the huts in the camp lay pure filth, and the more one worked to clear it away, the more one had to come in contact with it. It was a favorite practice to detail a new arrival to a work group whose job was to clean the latrines and remove the sewage. If, as usually happened, some of the excrement splashed into his face during its transport over the bumpy fields, any sign of disgust by the prisoner or any attempt to wipe off the filth would only be punished with a blow from a capo, and thus the mortification of normal reaction was hastened. At first, the prisoner looked away if he saw the punishment parades of another group. He could not bear to see fellow prisoners march up and down for hours in the mire, their movements directed by blows. Days or weeks later, things changed. Early in the morning, when it was still dark, the prisoner stood in front of the gate with his detachment ready to march. He heard a scream and saw how a comrade was knocked down, pulled to his feet again, and knocked down once more. And why? He was feverish but had reported to sick bay at an improper time. He was being punished for this irregular attempt to be relieved of his duties. But the prisoner, who had passed into the second stage of his psychological reactions, did not avert his eyes anymore. By then, his feelings were blunted, and he was unmoved. Another example. He found himself waiting at sick bay, hoping to be granted 2 days of light work instead, inside the camp because of injuries and or perhaps edema or fever. He stood unmoved while a 12-year-old boy was carried in, who had been forced to stand at attention for hours in the snow or to work outside with bare feet because there were no shoes for him in the camp. His toes had become frostbitten, and the doctor on duty picked off the black gangrenous stumps with tweezers one by one. Disgust, horror, and pity are emotions that our spectator could not really feel anymore. The sufferers, the dying, and the dead became such commonplace sights to him after a few weeks of camp life that they could not move him anymore. I spent some time in a hut for typhus patients who ran very high temperatures and were often delirious, many of them moribund. After one of them had just died, I watched without any emotional upset the scene that followed, which was repeated over and over again, which eat death. One by one, the prisoners approached the still warm body. One grabbed the remains of a messy meal of potatoes. Another decided that the corpse's wooden shoes were an improvement on his own and exchanged them. A third man did the same with the dead man's coat, and another was glad to be able to secure some. Just imagine, genuine strength. All this I watched with unconcern. Eventually, I asked the nurse to remove the body. When he decided to do so, he took the corpse by its legs, allowing it to drop into the small corridor between the two rows of boards, which were the beds for the 50 typhus patients, and dragged it across the bumpy earthen floor toward the door. The two steps which led up into the open air always constituted a problem for us, since we were exhausted from a chronic lack of food. After a few months' stay in the camp, we could not walk up those steps, which were each about six inches high, without putting our hands on the door jambs to pull ourselves up. The man with the corpse approached the steps. Wearily he dragged himself up, then the body, first the feet, then the trunk, and finally, with an uncanny rattling noise, the head of the corpse bumped up the two steps. My place was on the opposite side of the hut, next to the small sole window, which was built near the floor. While my cold hands clasped a bowl of hot soup from which I sipped greedily, I happened to look out the window. The corpse, which had just been removed, stared in at me with glazed eyes. 2 hours before I had spoken to that man, now I continued sipping my soup. If my lack of emotion had not surprised me from the standpoint of professional interest, I would not remember this incident now, because there was so little feeling involved in it.